Let's imagine that you want to deploy a containerized app inside Kubernetes cluster. So, how can you ensure that there are at least minimum of 3 pod instances are always available and running no matter what? Hello and welcome to ReplicaSet. My name is Srinath Challa. I'm a certified Kubernetes administrator. So in the next few minutes, I'll try my best to explain what is ReplicaSet and what is the difference between ReplicaSet and a replication controller and more. But before you watch this video, it is good to have a basic understanding of pods, replication controller and Kubernetes. In case if you need help with that, please do check links in the description below. So without any further delay, let's take a look at the things you'll be learning as part of this video. This presentation is divided into 2 parts. In part 1, we'll discuss the overview of ReplicaSet. Then we'll discuss about what are labels and selectors. And finally, we'll discuss about what is the difference between equality-based selectors and set-based selectors. And that's about the part 1. And now coming to the part 2, we will review the demo we are about to perform on live Kubernetes cluster in advance. And this will better understand when you watch actually doing it live. And in this review demo, we'll show you what goes inside the ReplicaSet Manifest file, then how to deploy the application using ReplicaSet, and once you deploy the application, then we'll display and validate the objects it has created. Next, we'll test the ReplicaSet with some of the use cases, and finally, we'll clean up what we have created in this video. In case if you're looking for actual demo on performing above steps on live Kubernetes cluster, then you can refer to the link provided in the description below. And now, let's get started with knowing what is ReplicaSet and what it does. So, what is a ReplicaSet exactly? ReplicaSet ensures that specified number of pod replicas are always running at any point in time. In other words, if you define there should be 5 pods running at any time using a ReplicaSet, then this controller will make sure that these 5 pods are up and running always. In case if there are too many pods running than what was defined in the manifest file, then the ReplicaSet will terminate the extra pods. And in the same way, if there are pods running less than defined in the manifest file, then the ReplicaSet will start more pods. Sometimes, pods do fail, deleted, or die for various reasons. And when they do die or deleted for any reasons, and if it's backed by a ReplicaSet, then these pods get automatically recreated on same node or another healthy node. So there will be a situation where you just want to run only one pod all the time. Then in that situation, you need to define the replica count as 1 in the manifest file. So that ReplicaSet always ensures that pod is always available. And it's actually a good idea and a best practice to create a ReplicaSet with count of 1, which means that even if the only pod that is running gets crashed or gets killed, then the ReplicaSet will bring that back. One very important point to note here is, how do these ReplicaSet aware of pods that it needs to manage? What is the link between ReplicaSet and pods that it needs to manage? Any guess? Answer is labels. Labels are nothing but a tag that was given to a pod. So using labels, we'll relate the ReplicaSet to pods that it needs to manage. Here, we'll mention the exact labels inside the pods and the ReplicaSet. We'll discuss more about labels and selectors in the upcoming slides. But before that, let's discuss about the controller that comes close to the ReplicaSet, which is replication controller. So, what is the difference between a replication controller and a ReplicaSet? ReplicaSet is the next generation of replication controller. Replication controller and a ReplicaSet both serve the same purpose. It is just older versus newer version. Everything we discussed in the replication controller still applies to the ReplicaSet. However, there is one difference between them, and that is selectors. ReplicaSet supports the set-based selectors, and whereas the replication controller supports the equality-based selectors. So before we go deep into this topic, let's take a step back to understand what are labels and selectors. And this will get everyone on the same page. including those who are not aware of it. As we know, pods are basic scheduling unit in Kubernetes, just like VM in the VMware world. And these pods provide a runtime environment for applications that we deploy. So when we deploy the applications, to have a better high availability and load balancing between the applications, we tend to deploy multiple instances of the applications for that. So there will be one pod per application instance. And if you scale your application instances to 10, there will be 10 pods. So how are these pods are managed at such a large scale? This is usually done by controllers and services such as replication controller, replica set, services, daemon sets, and so on. Here, the main question is, how do these controllers and services are aware of pods that it needs to manage? Answer is, labels and selectors. Labels are key value pairs that are generally attached to pods. It is kind of a tag that will be given to one or set of related pods together. And it will help us managing and displaying related pods together as a set instead of individual. And if you take this pod spec as an example, we have a pod named Nginx pod. And it has three labels as you can see. And if you take a first one, app is a key and guestbook is a value. And that's how we define the labels inside the pod. And these are the tags that was given to the Nginx pod that we defined here. So this pod spec that you're seeing here will deploy 5 Nginx pod instances inside our Kubernetes cluster. All these 5 pod instances has the same labels. On other side, we have selectors. Controllers and services manage these 5 pods using the selectors. So what goes inside these selectors? Any guess? Pod labels. There are 2 different ways that you can define selectors. One is the old way that is used in the equality-based selectors, which is used in a replication controller. And other is new set-based selectors, which is used in ReplicaSet. Now, let's see what they are and how do they differ. We have equality-based selectors on the left side and set-based selectors on the right side. First, let's take a look at the equality-based selectors. There are 3 kind of operators that we use in equality-based selectors. They are equal, double equal, and not equal. And that is one of the reasons why it is called as equality-based selectors. Here, first 2 operators are same, which is equal and double equal. You can use either one of them. On set-based side, there are 3 operators as well. They are in, not in, and exist. Next, let's take a look at some of the examples and see how these operators are used. On this side, we have 2 examples. The first example, we are selecting all pods whose environment is production. And in the second example, we are selecting all tiers except the front end. On the other side, you can give 2 or more options. And this is a primary advantage of set-based selectors. So you are selecting the pods whose environments are in production and in the QA. In the following example, you are selecting all pods whose tiers are not in front-end or back-end. Here, you are selecting the pods from set of options, and that's why it's called as set-based selectors. So now, how are these selectors are used along with kubectl command? This way. In these examples, we are selecting and displaying all pods whose environment is production. As you can see, we are using the equal operator on this side and in operator on other side. So how are these defined in manifest or spec file? Like this. On this side, it is very simple. We are defining the keyword selector. Underneath that, we can copy the exact content of pod label as it is. On other side, we have a slight different approach. And we have a keyword called match expression under the selector. After that, we use key, operator, and values. If we take the first line item in the example, we are selecting all pods whose environment is prod and QA. And the other one, we are selecting all pods whose pods are not front-end or the back-ends. So these are the 2 different types of selectors. If you look at this at a very high level, you'll get like 2 points. And that is, equality-based selectors are easy to use and understand, but less powerful than set-based selectors. Whereas, set-based selectors are a bit complex, but more powerful than equality-based selectors. So, which one to use? It depends on your requirement. But if you're just starting to learn about Kubernetes, practice with equality-based selectors. And once you're comfortable with it, then you can start using the set-based selectors as and when needed. In our demo, we'll deploy an application with ReplicaSet using both examples. Before we head into the demo, there is something to clarify. In my initial days with Kubernetes, this thing confused me quite a lot. I used to see a spec file with two different types of selectors, one with match labels and other without match labels. This has really confused me a lot. Not sure where to use which one. Finally, after spending an hour or two on Google, I found an answer. And that is, we use selectors without match labels on older resources such as replication controller and services. And we use selectors with match labels on newer resources such as replica sets, deployments, jobs, and daemon sets. And now it's time to move on to the review demo section. In next few slides, we'll review the demo we are able to perform on live Kubernetes cluster in advance. First, we'll see what goes inside a ReplicaSet manifest file. Then, we'll deploy the application using ReplicaSet. After that, we'll deploy the ReplicaSet to make sure it is created as per our expectations. Then, we'll start testing the couple of scenarios to make sure it is working as per our expectations. In first scenario, we'll test the pod rescheduling when node fails. In this case, we'll make sure the ReplicaSet will create new pods on healthy node inside the Kubernetes cluster. Next, we will assume there is a surge in traffic. Then, we will scale up the application instances running inside the cluster. Finally, we will scale down the application instances, assuming the traffic has returned to the normal. And now, let's start with writing the manifest file for ReplicaSet. Config file of ReplicaSet is almost similar to the replication controller, but with a very small minor differences. And let's write down the definition of a ReplicaSet. Like any other Kubernetes object config file, ReplicaSet contains four top sections. They are API version, kind, metadata, and spec. Let's go by one by one. First, API version. API version of a ReplicaSet is apps v1. Then kind. Kind of the object that we are creating here is ReplicaSet. So we have it here. Then follows the metadata. Two things that goes under this primarily are, one is name of the object, other is label. Here, name of the ReplicaSet is Nginx RS. You can define the labels for this ReplicaSet if needed here, but for now, we'll skip it. Finally, we have a spec section. Can you guess what goes here in the spec section? If you remember the purpose of ReplicaSet, you will get an answer. Answer is, it creates multiple replicas of pod instances for high availability and load balances purposes. So, we are talking about the replicas and pods here. In our example, let's have a 3 replicas of pod. Next, we need to define the pod template. So, the pod configuration comes under the template section. The question here is, how do that ReplicaSet will get to know about the Nginx pods? Any guess? It is with the help of labels and selectors. We have already defined label for the pod, which is app Nginx app, and the tier as frontend. Next, we need to define the selector. And this is where all the biggest difference between ReplicaSet and replication controller comes into the picture. As we discussed in depth previously, there are two ways to define this selector, one with match labels and other with match expressions. We use match labels when there is key and only one value. Here, we just have only one value, which is Nginx app. In case if there are set of values to select from, then we use match expressions. The way we define the match expressions is by key, operator, and value. Here, key will be always one string value, which in this case is tier. Operator can be in or not in. And finally, we have a value which in this case has front end. You can have a more values by using comma after front end. But in this example, we have just one value which is front end. So we can use match labels instead of match expressions, which I personally feel a bit easy for this case. So I showed you this to explain this concept. To summarize this, we have an API version, kind, metadata, and spec. Under spec, we define the number of replicas, pod configuration, and selector. The major difference between replica set and the replication controller comes in the selector section as we discussed. Now, let's go ahead and create this replica set. We use kubectl create-f command followed by the object file name, which is nginx-rs.yaml file. Once you run that command, you should see the nginx-rs replica set is created. Then, we use the kubectl get command followed by pods to display the pods it has created. As you can see, there are three nginx pods which are created by nginx-rs replica set. And its status shows that all three pods are running successfully, and which is what we are expecting. Let's assume that there are 100 other pods which are in same running status. Now, we need to just want to display the pods which has the label of frontend. So, how can you just display that? Answer is, all we need to do is filter the pods whose labels are tagged with frontend. We can do that by adding a label at the end of kubectl get command, just like this. Now, to describe the complete details about this nginx rs replica set, we use the describe command, and we'll see that in next slide. Before we get into the describe command, let's get the wide output of nginx rs replica set. There you see at the end where the both selectors are displayed. Next, let us display the complete details about a specific replica set. Here, we are displaying the nginx rs replica set. As you can see, labels and selectors of the pod, then the status of the pod where all three are running and zero failed. Next comes the pod template, which has a list of containers this pod has. And as we see, there is only one Nginx container running. Finally, you can see the list of the events where it shows all three pods are created. And this is one of the very important command when it comes to the troubleshooting. So far, we have created the replica set, then displayed and verified to make sure it is working. Now, let's test some of the use cases of replica set, which includes how these pods are rescheduled when the underlying node dies. Second, how to scale up when there is an increase in load and scale down when there is no load. First, let's look at how the rescheduling of the pods happens when the underlying node dies. We have two work nodes in our cluster. They are running on node 1 and node 2. So let's test to see what happens if the pod on node 2 dies. And it manually went and shut down the node 2. Now, to make sure the node 2 is down from the command line, we will execute the kubectl get command followed by node. As you can see, node 2 is now in not ready status. At this stage, let's give it a few minutes to the master node. After some time, let's display the pods with a wide output running this command. As you see, the status of the pod on node 2 changed to the unknown and it recreated the pod on node 1. After some time, pod with unknown status will just go off automatically. So, this is what happens when the underlying node dies. Next use case that we are going to test is scaling up the replicas. Here in this use case, we'll scale up the replica count. Let's assume you notice there is a sudden increase in traffic from end users accessing your web servers. Currently, there are three instances which are getting burned down very fastly. We came to a conclusion and now it's time to increase the application instances based on the load. So to scale up the application instances from current 3 to 5, we use the kubectl scale command with replica option to 5. Once the command is executed, now let's display the replica set to check how many instances are running. As you can see, there are 5 replicas are currently running and in ready status. And it matches to our desired count and which is 5. Let's execute the kubectl get pods to display the number of pods currently running under the Nginx RS replica set. As you see, there is an increase in pods from 3 to 5, and there are two new pods created, one running on node 1 and other is running on node 2. And this is how we scale up the replica set. And now, let's go ahead and scale down the application instances. Once the load and traffic from outside world is down to normal, then you can bring down the replica count. You can use the same exact process. All the difference here is replica count to 3. To verify, we use kubectl get replica set command to display. Here, RS is the short form of replica set. As you can see, desired and current are same, which is 3. Now, to see on which nodes these pods are currently running, we use kubectl get pods with wide option. There are two pods running on node 1 and one is running on node 2. Finally, it's time to clean up the things here. So to delete the replica set, we use kubectl delete command with -f option followed by config file. And this will delete all the objects which are created as part of this config file, which includes pod and replica set. Please note, if you delete a replica set, and it will delete all the pods which comes under its control. Now, to make sure, we'll display the pods with label Nginx app. As you see, there are none. So far, we have discussed about what is replica set, how to create and tested some of the use cases of it. So before we move on to the next video, let's review some of the important things that we discussed in this video so far. So coming to the summary, in first section, we discussed the concept around replica set. Where we discussed, replica set ensures that a specified number of pods are running at any point in time, always. And replica set is the next generation of replication controller. The primary difference between them is, replica set supports both equality-based selector and a set-based selector. And whereas replication controller supports only equality-based selectors. Next, we also discussed about the difference between equality-based and set-based selectors. And that's about the part 1. Now coming to the part 2, where we review the demo we are about to perform live on Kubernetes cluster in advance. In that review demo, we saw what goes inside a replica set manifest file. Majorly, replicas and selectors are two most important fields which makes this special. Then, we deployed the application using replica set. And once the application is deployed, we displayed and validated the objects it has created. Then, we tested some of the use cases of replica set by automatic rescheduling of pods when underlying node fails or dies for any unknown reason, then scaling up and scaling down the application instances. And finally, we cleaned up what we have created in this demo. And now, it's time to move on to the next video in this Kubernetes series, and which is actual demo of replica set. In the demo, we'll perform the exact steps that we just discussed in the review demo section. A link to that video is provided in the description below. And finally, thank you so much for watching this, and I hope to see you in the next video.